Hey comrades, so today we're reading Wage, Labor, and Capital. I've skipped the introduction by Engels, so we're starting on the section called Preliminary instead. From various quarters, we have been reproached for neglecting to portray the economic conditions which form the material basis of the present struggles between classes and nations. With set purpose, we have hitherto touched upon these conditions only when they forced themselves upon the surface of the political conflicts. It was necessary, beyond everything else, to follow the development of the class struggle in the history of our own day and to provide empirically, by the actual and daily newly created historical material, that with the subjugation of the working class accomplished in the days of February and March 1848. The opponents of that class, the bourgeois republicans in France and the bourgeois and peasant classes who were fighting feudal absolutism through the whole continent of Europe, were simultaneously conquered. That the victory of the quote-unquote moderate republic in France sounded at the same time the fall of the nations which had responded to the February Revolution with heroic wars of independence. And finally, that, by the victory over the revolutionary working men, Europe fell back into its old double slavery, into the English-Russian slavery, the June conflict in Paris, the fall of Vienna, the tragi-comedy in Berlin in November 1848, the desperate efforts of Poland, Italy, and Hungary, the starvation of Ireland into submission. These were chief events which the European class struggle between the bourgeoisie and the working class was summed up, and from which we proved that every revolutionary uprising, however remote from the class struggle its object might appear, must of necessity fail until the revolutionary working class shall have conquered, that every social reform must remain a utopia until the proletarian revolution and the feudalistic counter-revolution have been pitted against each other in a worldwide war. In our presentation, as in reality, Belgium and Switzerland were trachonomic, caricaturish genre pictures in the great historic tableau, the one the model state of the bourgeois monarchy, the other the model state of the bourgeois republic. Both of them, states that flatter themselves to be just as free from the class struggle as from the European Revolution. But now, after our readers have seen the class struggle of the year 1848 develop into colossal political proportions, it is time to examine more closely the economic conditions themselves upon which is founded the existence of the capitalist class and its class rule, as well as the slavery of the workers. We shall present the subject in three great divisions: the relation of wage labor to capital, the slavery of the worker, the rule of the capitalist. The inevitable ruin of the middle classes, petty bourgeois, and the so-called commons, peasants, under the present system. The commercial subjugation and exploitation of the bourgeois classes of the various European nations by the despot of the world market, England. We shall seek to portray this as simply and popularly as possible, and shall not presuppose a knowledge of even the most elementary notions of political economy. We wish to be understood by the workers, and moreover, there prevails in Germany the most remarkable ignorance and confusion of ideas in regard to the simplest economic relations, from the patented defenders of existing conditions down to the socialist wonder workers and the unrecognized political geniuses in which divided Germany is even richer than in duodecimo principlings. We therefore proceed to the consideration of the first problem. So this first part is called, What are wages? How are they determined? If several workmen were asked, How much wages do you get? One would reply, I get 2 shillings a day, and so on, according to the different branches of industry in which they are employed. They would mention different sums of money that they receive from their respective employers for the completion of certain tasks. For example, for weaving a yard of linen, or for setting a page of type. Despite the variety of their statements, they would all agree upon one point, that wages are the amount of money which the capitalist pays for a certain period of work or for a certain amount of work. Consequently, it appears that the capitalist buys their labor with money, and that for money they sell him their labor. But this is merely an illusion. What they actually sell to the capitalist for money is their labor power. This labor power the capitalist buys for a day, a week, a month, etc. And after he has bought it, he uses it up by letting the worker labor during the stipulated time. With the same amount of money with which the capitalist has bought their labor power, for example, with 2 shillings, he could have bought a certain amount of sugar or of any other commodity. The 2 shillings with which he bought 20 pounds of sugar is the price of the 20 pounds of sugar. The 2 shillings with which he bought the 12 hours use of a labor power is the price of 12 hours labor. Labor power, then, is a commodity, no more, no less so, than is the sugar. The first is measured by the clock, the other by the scales. Their commodity, labor power, the workers exchange for the commodity of the capitalist, for money, and moreover, this exchange takes place at a certain ratio. So much money for so long a use of labor power. For 12 hours weaving, 2 shillings. And then these 2 shillings, do they not represent all the other commodities which I can buy for 2 shillings? Therefore, actually, the worker has exchanged his commodity, labor power, for commodities of all kinds, and moreover, at a certain ratio, by giving him 2 shillings, the capitalist has given him so much meat, so much clothing, so much wood, light, etc., in exchange for his day's work. The 2 shillings, therefore, express the relation in which labor power is exchanged for the other commodities, the exchange value of labor power. The exchange value of a commodity estimated in money is called its price. Wages, therefore, are only a special name for the price of labor power, and are usually called the price of labor. It is the special name for the price of this particular commodity, which has no other repository than human flesh and blood. Let us take any worker, for example, a weaver. The capitalist supplies him with the loom and the yarn. The weaver applies himself to work, and the yarn is turned into cloth. The capitalist takes possession of the cloth and sells it for 20 shillings, for example. Now, are the wages of the weaver a share of the cloth, of the 20 shillings, of the product of the work? By no means. Long before the cloth is sold, perhaps long before it is fully woven, the weaver has received his wages. The capitalist, then, does not pay his wages out of the money which he will obtain from the cloth, but out of money already in hand, just as little as loom and yarn are the product of the weaver to whom they are supplied by the employer. Just so little are the commodities which he receives in exchange for his commodity, labor power, his product. It is possible that the employer found no purchasers at all for the cloth. It is possible that he did not get even the amount of wages by its sale. It is possible that he sells it very profitably in proportion but to the weaver's wages. But all that does not concern the weaver. With a part of his existing wealth of his capital, the capitalist buys the labor power of the weaver in exactly the same manner as with other part of his wealth. He has bought the raw material, the yarn, and the instrument of labor, the loom. After he has made these purchases, and among them belongs the labor power necessary to the production of the cloth he produces, only with raw materials and instruments of labor belonging to him. For our good weaver, too, is one of the instruments of labor, and being in this respect on par with the loom, he has no more share in the product, the cloth, or in the price of the product than the loom itself has. Wages, therefore, are not a share of the worker in the commodities produced by himself. Wages are that part of already existing commodities with which the capitalist buys a certain amount of productive labor power. Consequently, labor power is a commodity which its professor, the wage worker, sells to the capitalist. Why does he sell it? It is in order to live. But the putting of labor power into action, i.e. the work, is the active expression of the laborer's own life. And this life activity he sells to another person in order to secure the necessary means of life. His life activity, therefore, is but a means of securing his own existence. He works that he may keep alive. He does not count the labor itself as a part of his life. It is rather a sacrifice of his life. It is a commodity that he has auctioned off to another. The product of his activity, therefore, is not the aim of his activity. What he produces for himself is not the silk that he weaves, not the gold that he draws up the mining shaft, not the palace that he builds. What he produces for himself is wages. The silk, the gold, and the palace are resolved for him into a certain quantity of necessaries of life. Perhaps into a cotton jacket, into copper coins, into basement dwelling. And the laborer, who for 12 hours long weaves, spins, bores, turns, builds, shovels, breaks stone, carries hods, and so on, is this 12 hours weaving, spinning, boring, turning, shoveling, stone breaking regarded by him as a manifestation of life, as life? Quite the contrary. Life for him begins whereas activity ceases, at the table, at the tavern, in bed. The 12 hours' work, on the other hand, has no meaning for him as weaving, spinning, boring, and so on, but only as earnings, which enable him to sit down at a table, to take his seat in the tavern, to lie down in a bed. If the silkworm's object in spinning were to prolong its existence as a caterpillar, it would be a perfect example of a wage worker. Labor power was not always a commodity, merchandise. Labor was not always wage labor, i.e. free labor. The slave did not sell his labor power to the slave owner any more than the ox sells his labor to the farmer. The slave, together with his labor power, was sold to his owner once and for all. He is a commodity that can pass from the hand of one owner to that of another. He himself is a commodity, but his labor power is not his commodity. The serf sells only a portion of his labor power. It is not he who receives wages from the owner of the land. It is rather the owner of the land who receives a tribute from him. The serf belongs to the soil, and the lord of the soil, he brings its fruit. The free laborer, on the other hand, sells his very self, and that by fractions. He auctions off 8, 10, 12, 15 hours of his life one day, like the next, to the highest bidder, to the owner of raw materials, tools, and the means of life, i.e. to the capitalist. The laborer belongs neither to an owner nor to the soil, but 8, 10, 12, 15 hours of his daily life belong to whomsoever buys them. The worker leaves the capitalist, to whom he has sold himself, as long as he chooses, and the capitalist discharges him as often as he sees fit. As soon as he no longer gets any use, or not the required use of him, out of him. But the worker, whose only source of income is the sale of his labor power, cannot leave the whole class of buyers, i.e. the capitalist class, unless he gives up his own existence. He does not belong to this or that capitalist, but to the capitalist class, and it is for him to find his man, i.e. to find a buyer in this capitalist class. Before entering more closely upon the relation of capital to wage labor, we shall present briefly the most general conditions which come into consideration in the determination of wages. Wages, as we have seen, are the price of a certain amount of commodity, labor power. Wages, therefore, are determined by the same laws that determine the price of every other commodity. The question, then, how is the price of a commodity determined? By what is the price of a commodity determined? By the competition between buyers and sellers, by the relation of the demand to the supply, of the call to the offer. The competition by which the price of a commodity is determined is threefold. The same commodity is offered for sale by various sellers. Whoever sells commodities of the same quality most cheaply is sure to drive the other sellers from the field and to secure the greatest market for himself. The sellers, therefore, fight amongst themselves for the sales, for the market. Each one of them wishes to sell, and to sell as much as possible, and if possible, to sell alone, to the exclusion of all other sellers. Each one sells cheaper than the other. Thus, there takes place a competition among the sellers, which forces down the price of the commodities offered by them. But there is also a competition among the buyers. This, upon its side, causes the price of the proffered commodities to rise. Finally, there is a competition between the buyers and the sellers. These wish to purchase as cheaply as possible, those to sell as dearly as possible. The result of this competition between buyers and sellers will depend upon the relations between the two above-mentioned camps of competitors, i.e., upon whether the competition in the army of sellers is stronger. Industry leads two great armies into field against each other, and each of these again is engaged in a battle among its own troops in its own ranks. The army among whose troops there is less fighting carries off the victory over the opposing host. Let us suppose that there are 100 bales of cotton in the market, and at the same time purchasers for 1,000 bales of cotton. In this case, the demand is 10 times greater than the supply. Competition among the buyers, then, will be very strong. Each of them tries to get a hold of one bale, if possible, of the whole 100 bales. This example is no arbitrary supposition. In the history of commerce, we have experienced periods of scarcity of cotton, when some capitalists unite together and sought to buy up not 100 bales, but the whole cotton supply of the world. In the given case, then, one buyer seeks to drive the others from the field by offering a relatively higher price for the bales of cotton. The cotton sellers, who perceive the troops of the enemy in the most violent contention among themselves, and who therefore are fully assured of the sale of their whole 100 bales, will beware of pulling one another's hair in order to force down the price of cotton at the very moment in which their opponents race with one another to screw it up high. So, all of a sudden, peace reigns in the army of sellers. They stand opposed to the buyers like one man, fold their arms in philosophic contentment, and their claims would find no limit, did not the offers of even the most importunate of buyers have a very definite limit. If, then, the supply of a commodity is less than the demand for it, competition among the sellers is very slight, or there may be none at all among them. In the same proportion in which this competition decreases, the competition among the buyers increases. Result, a more or less considerable rise in the prices of commodities. It is well known that the opposite case, with the opposite result, happens more frequently. Great excess of supply over demand, desperate competition among the sellers, and a lack of buyers, forced sales of commodities at ridiculously low prices. But what is a rise and what a fall of prices? What is a high and what is a low price? A grain of sand is high when examined through a microscope, and a tower is low when compared with a mountain. And if the price is determined by the relation of supply and demand, by what is the relation of supply and demand determined? Let us turn to the first worthy citizen we meet. He will not hesitate one moment, but, like Alexander the Great, will cut this metaphysical knot with his multiplication table. He will say to us, if the production of the commodities which I sell has cost me £100, and out of the sale of these goods I make £110, within the year, you understand, that's an honest, sound, reasonable profit. But if in the exchange I receive £120 or £130, that's a higher profit. And if I should get as much as £200, that would be an extraordinary and enormous profit. What is it, then, that serves this citizen as a standard of his profit? The cost of the production of his commodities. If in exchange for these goods he receives a quantity of other goods whose production has cost less, he has lost. If he receives in exchange for his goods a quantity of other goods whose production has cost more, he has gained, and he reckons the falling and rising of the profit according to the degree at which the exchange value of his goods stands, whether above or below his zero, the cost of production. We have seen how the changing relation of supply and demand causes now a rise and fall of prices, now high, now low prices. If the price of a commodity rises considerably owing to a failing supply or a disproportionately growing demand, then the price of some other commodity must have fallen in proportion. For, of course, the price of a commodity only expresses in money the proportion in which the other commodities will be given in exchange for it. If, for example, the price of a yard of silk rises from 2 to 3 shillings, the price of silver has fallen in relation to the silk, and in the same way the prices of All other commodities whose prices have remained stationary have fallen in relation to the price of silk. A large quantity of them must be given in exchange in order to obtain the same amount of silk. Now, what will be the consequence of a rise in the price of a particular commodity? A mass of capital will be thrown into the prosperous branch of industry, and this immigration of capital into the provinces of the favored industry will continue until it yields no more than the customary profits, or rather until the price of its products, owing to the overproduction, sinks below the cost of production. Conversely, if the price of a commodity falls below its cost of production, then capital will be withdrawn from the production of this commodity, except in the case of a branch of industry which has become obsolete and therefore doomed to disappear. The production of such a commodity, that is, its supply, will, owing to this flight of capital, continue to decrease until it corresponds to the demand, and the price of the commodity rises again to the level of its cost of production. Or rather, until the supply has fallen below the demand and its price has risen above its cost of production, for the current price of a commodity is always either above or below its cost of production. We see how capital continually emigrates from out of the province of one industry and immigrates into that of another. The high price produces an excessive immigration and the low price an excessive emigration. We could show from another point of view how not only the supply, but also the demand is determined by the cost of production, but this would lead us too far away from our subject. We have just seen how the fluctuation of supply and demand always brings the price of a commodity back to its cost of production. The actual price of a commodity, indeed, stands always above or below the cost of production, but the rise and fall reciprocally balance each other, so that, with a certain period of time, if the ebbs and flows of the industry are reckoned up together, the commodities will be exchanged for one another in accordance with their cost of production. Their price is thus determined by their cost of production. The determination of price by the cost of production is not to be understood in the sense of bourgeois economists. The economists say that the average price of commodities equals the cost of production. That is the law. The anarchic movement, in which the rise is compensated for by a fall, and the fall by a rise, they regard as an accident. We might just as well consider the fluctuations as the law, and determination of the price by cost production as an accident, as is, in fact, done by certain other economists. But as precisely these fluctuations, which, viewed more closely, carry the most frightful devastation in their train, and like an earthquake, cause bourgeois society to shake to its very foundations, it is precisely these fluctuations that force the price to conform to the cost of production. In the totality of this disorderly movement is to be found its order. In the total course of this industrial anarchy, in this circular movement, competition balances, as it were, the one extravagance by the other. We thus see that the price of a commodity is indeed determined by the cost of its production, but in such a manner that the periods in which the price of these commodities rise above the cost of production are balanced by the periods in which it sinks below the cost of production, and vice versa. Of course, this does not hold good for a single given product of an industry, but only for a branch of industry. So it also does not hold good for an individual manufacturer, but only for the whole class of manufacturers. The determination of a price by cost of production is tantamount in the determination of a price by the labor time requisite to the production of a commodity, for the cost of production consists first of raw materials and wear and tear of tools, etc., of industrial products whose production has cost a certain number of work days, which therefore represent a certain amount of labor time, and secondly, of direct labor, which is also measured by its duration. By what are wages determined? Now, the same general laws which regulate the price of commodities in general naturally regulate wages or the price of labor power. Wages will now rise and now fall according to the relation of supply and demand, according to the competition shapes itself between the buyers of labor power, the capitalists, and the sellers of labor power, the workers. The fluctuations of wages correspond to the fluctuation in the price of commodities in general, but within the limits of these fluctuations, the price of labor power will be determined by the cost of production, by the labor time necessary for the production of this commodity, labor power. What, then, is the cost of production of labor power? It is the cost required for the maintenance of the laborer as a laborer and for his education and training as a laborer. Therefore, the shorter the time required for training up to a particular sort of work, the smaller the cost of production of the worker, the lower is the price of his labor power, his wages. In those branches of industry in which hardly any period of his apprenticeship is necessary, and the mere bodily existence of the worker is sufficient, the cost of his production is limited almost exclusively to the commodities necessary for keeping him in working condition. The price of his work will therefore be determined by the price of the necessary means of subsistence. Here, however, there enters another consideration. The manufacturer who calculates his cost of production, and in accordance with it, the price of the product, takes into account the wear and tear of the instruments of labor. If a machine costs him, for example, 1,000 shillings, and this machine is used in up 10 years, he adds 100 shillings annually to the price of the commodities, in order to be able, after 10 years, to replace the worn-out machine with a new one. In the same manner, the cost of production of simple labor power must include the cost of propagation by means of which the race of workers is enabled to multiply itself, and to replace worn-out workers with new ones. The wear and tear of the worker, therefore, is calculated in the same manner as the wear and tear of the machine. Thus, the cost of production of a simple labor power amounts to the cost of the existence of propagation of the worker. The price of this cost of existence and propagation constitutes wages. The wages thus determined are called the minimum wages. This minimum wage, like the determination of the price of commodities in general by the cost of production, does not hold good for the single individual, but only for the race. Individual workers, indeed millions of workers, do not receive enough to be able to exist and to propagate themselves, but the wages of the whole working class adjust themselves within the limits of their fluctuations to this minimum. Now that we have come to an understanding in regard to the most general laws which govern wages, as well as the price of every other commodity, we can examine our subject more particularly. The nature and growth of capital. Capital consists of raw materials, instruments of labor, and means of subsistence of all kinds, which are employed in producing new raw materials, new instruments, and new means of subsistence. All these components of capital are created by labor, products of labor, accumulated labor. Accumulated labor that serves as means to new production is capital. So say the economists. What is a Negro slave? A man of the black race. The one explanation is worthy of another. A Negro is a Negro. Only under certain conditions does he become a slave. A cotton spinning machine is a machine for spinning cotton. Only under certain conditions does it become a capital. Torn away from these conditions, it is as little capital as gold is itself money, or sugar is the price of sugar. In the process of production, human beings work not only upon nature, but also upon one another. They produce only by working together in a specified manner and reciprocally exchange their activities. In order to produce, they enter into definite connections and relations to one another, and only within these social connections and relations does their influence upon nature operate, i.e., does production take place. These social relations between the producers and the conditions under which they exchange their activities and share in the total act of production will naturally vary according to the character of the means of production, with the discovery of a new instrument of warfare, the firearm. The whole internal organization of the army was necessarily altered. The relations within which individuals compose an army and can work as an army were transformed in the relation to different armies to another was likewise changed. We thus see the social relations within which individuals produce and the social relations of production are altered, transformed, with the change and development of material means of production, of the forces of production. The relations of production in their totality constitute what is called the social relations society, and moreover, a society at a definite stage of historical development, a society with a particular distinctive characteristics. Ancient society, feudal society, bourgeois or capitalist society are totalities of relations of production, each of which denotes a particular stage of development in the history of mankind. Capital is also a social relation of production. It is a bourgeois relation of production and a relation of production of bourgeois society. The means of subsistence, the instruments of labor, the raw materials of which capital consists, have they not been produced and accumulated under given social conditions within special relations? Are they not employed for new production under given special conditions within definite social relations? And does not justify the definite social character stamp the products which serve for new production as capital? Capital consists not only of means of subsistence, instruments of labor, and raw materials, not only as material products, it consists just as much of exchange values, all products of which it consists are commodities. Capital, consequently, is not only a sum of material products, it is a sum of commodities, of exchange values, of social magnitudes. Capital remains the same whether we put cotton in the place of wool, rice in the place of wheat, steamships in the place of railroads, provided only that the cotton, rice, the steamships, the body of capital, have the same exchange value, the same price, as the wool, the wheat, the railroads in which it was previously embodied. The bodily form of capital may transform itself continually, while capital does not suffer the least alteration. But though every capital is a sum of commodities, i.e. of exchange values, it does not follow that every sum of commodities of exchange values is capital. Every sum of exchange values is an exchange value. Each particular exchange value is a sum of exchange values. For example, a house worth £1,000 is an exchange value of £1,000. A piece of paper worth one penny is a sum exchange values of 100/100 of a penny. Products which are exchangeable for other commodities, the definite proportion in which they are exchangeable forms in their exchange value, or expressed in money, their price. The quantity of these products can have no effect on their character as commodities, as representing an exchange value, as having a certain price. Whether a tree be large or small, it remains a tree. Whether we exchange iron in pennyweights or in hundredweights for other products, does this alter its character, its being a commodity or exchange value? According to the quantity, it is a commodity of greater or lesser value, of higher or lower price. How, then, does a sum of commodities of exchange values become capital? Thereby, that as an independent social power, i.e., as the power of a part of society, it preserves itself and multiplies by exchange with direct living labor power. The existence of a class which possesses nothing but the ability to work is a necessary presupposition of capital. It is only the domination of past accumulated materialized labor over immediate living labor that stamps the accumulated labor with the character of capital. Capital does not consist in the fact that accumulated labor serves living labor as a means for new production. It consists in the fact that living labor serves accumulated labor as the means of preserving and multiplying its exchange value. Relation of wage labor to capital. What is it that takes place in the exchange between the capitalist and the wage laborer? The laborer receives a means of subsistence in exchange for his labor power. The capitalist receives in exchange for his means of subsistence labor, the productive activity of the laborer, the creative force by which the worker not only replaces what he consumes, but also gives to the accumulated labor a greater value than it previously possessed. The laborer gets from the capitalist a portion of the existing means of subsistence. For what purpose do these means of subsistence serve him? For immediate consumption. But as soon as I consume means of subsistence, they are irrevocably lost to me, unless I employ the time during which these means sustain my life in producing new means of subsistence and creating by my labor new values in the place of the values lost in consumption. But it is just this noble reproductive power that the laborer surrenders to the capitalist in exchange for means of subsistence received. Consequently, he has lost it for himself. Let us take an example. For 1 shilling, a laborer works all day long in the fields of a farmer, to whom he thus secures a return of 2 shillings. The farmer not only receives the replaced value which he has given to the day of laborer, he has doubled it. Therefore, he has consumed the 1 shilling that he gave to the day laborer in a fruitful, productive manner. For the 1 shilling, he has bought the labor power of the day laborer, which creates products of the soil of twice the value, and out of the 1 shilling makes 2. The day laborer, on the contrary, receives in the place of his productive forces, whose result he has just surrendered to the farmer, 1 shilling, which he exchanges for means of subsistence, which he consumes more or less quickly. The 1 shilling has therefore been consumed in a double manner, reproductively for the capitalist, for it has been exchanged for labor power, which brought forth 2 shillings, unproductively for the worker, for it has been exchanged for means of subsistence, which are lost forever, and whose value he can obtain again only by repeating the same exchange with the farmer. Capital, therefore, presupposes wage labor. Wage labor presupposes capital. They condition each other. Each brings the other into existence. Does a worker in a cotton factory produce only cotton? No, he produces capital. He produces values which serve anew to command his work and to create by means of it new values. Capital can multiply itself only by exchanging itself for labor power, by calling wage labor into life. The labor power of the wage laborer can exchange itself for capital only by increasing capital, by strengthening that very power whose slave it is. Increase of capital, therefore, is increase of the proletariat, i.e. of the working class. And so, the bourgeoisie and its economists maintain that the interest of the capitalist and of the laborer is the same. And in fact, so they are. The worker perishes if capital does not keep him busy. Capital perishes if it does not exploit labor power, which, in order to exploit it, must buy. The more quickly the capitalist destined for production, the productive capital increases. The more prosperous industry is, the more the bourgeoisie enriches itself, the better business gets, so many more workers does the capitalist need, so much the dearer does the worker sell himself. The fastest possible growth of productive capital is, therefore, the indispensable condition for a tolerable life to the laborer. But what is the growth of productive capital? Growth of the power of accumulated labor over living labor. Growth of the rule of the bourgeoisie over the working class. When wage labor produces the alien wealth dominating it, the power hostile to it, the capital there flow back to its means of employment, i.e. its means of subsistence, under the condition that it again become a part of the capital. That is, become again the lever whereby capital is to be forced to an accelerated expansive movement. To say that the interests of capital and the interests of the workers are identical signifies only this, that capital and wage labor are on two sides of one and the same relation. The one conditions the other in the same way that the usurer and the borrower condition each other. As long as the wage laborer remains a wage laborer, his lot is dependent upon capital. That is what the boasted community of interest between the worker and capitalists amount to. If capital grows, the mass of wage labor grows, the number of wage workers increases. In a word, the sway of capital extends over a great mass of individuals. Let us suppose the favorable case. If productive capital grows, the demand for labor grows. It therefore increases the price of labor power wages. A house may be large or small, as long as the neighboring houses are likewise small, it satisfies all social requirement for a resident. But let arise next to the little house a palace, and the little house shrinks to a hut. The little house now makes it clear that its inmate has no social position at all to maintain, or but a very insignificant one. And however high it may shoot up in course of civilization, if the neighboring palaces rise in equal or even in greater measure, the occupant of the relatively little house will always find himself more uncomfortable, more dissatisfied, more cramped within its four walls. An appreciable rise in wages presupposes a rapid growth of productive capital. Rapid growth of productive capital calls forth just as a rapid growth of wealth, of luxury, of social needs, and social pleasures. Therefore, although the pleasures of the laborer have increased, the social gratification which they afford has fallen in comparison. With the increased pleasures of the capitalist, which are inaccessible to the worker, in comparison with the stage of development of society in general, our wants and pleasures have their origins in society. We therefore measure them in relation to society. We do not measure them in relation to the objects which serve for their gratification. Since they are of a social nature, they are of a relative nature. But wages are not at all determined merely by a sum of commodities for which they may be exchanged. Other factors enter into the problem. What the workers directly receive for their labor power is a certain sum of money. Are wages determined merely by this money price? In the 16th century, the gold and silver circulation in Europe increased in consequence of the discovery of richer and more easily worked mines in America. The value of gold and silver, therefore, fell in relation to other commodities. The workers received the same amount of coined silver for their labor power as before. The money price of their work remained the same, and yet their wages had fallen. For in exchange for the same amount of silver, they obtained a smaller amount of other commodities. This was one of the circumstances which furthered the growth of capital, the rise of the bourgeoisie in the 18th century. Let us take another case. In the winter of 1847, in consequence of a bad harvest, the most indispensable means of subsistence, grains, meat, butter, cheese, etc., rose greatly in price. Let us suppose that the workers still received the same sum of money for their labor power as before. Did not their wages fall? To be sure, for the same money they received in exchange less bread, meat, etc., their wages fell, not because the value of silver was less, but because the value of the means of subsistence had increased. Finally, let us suppose that the money price of labor power remained the same, while all agricultural and manufactured commodities had fallen in price because of the employment of new machines, of favorable seasons, etc. For the same money, the workers could now buy more commodities of all kinds. Their wages have therefore risen, just because their money value has not changed. The money price of labor power, the normal wages, do not therefore coincide with the actual or real wages, i.e. with the amount of commodities which are actually given in exchange for the wages. If, then, we speak of a rise or fall of wages, we have to keep in mind not only the money price of labor power, the nominal wages, but also the real wages. But neither the nominal wages, i.e. the amount of money for which laborer sells himself to the capitalist, nor the real wages, i.e. the amount of commodities which he can buy for this money, exhaust the relations which are comprehended in the term wages. Wages are determined above all by their relations to the gain, the profit of the capitalist. In other words, wages are a proportionate relative quantity. Real wages express the price of labor power in relation to the price of commodities. Relative wages, on the other hand, express the share of immediate labor in the value newly created by it, in relation to the share of it which falls to accumulated labor, to capital. The general law that determines the rise and fall of wages and profits. We have said, wages are not a share of the worker in the commodities produced by him. Wages are a part of already existing commodities with which the capitalist buys a certain amount of productive labor power. But the capitalist must replace these wages out of the price for which he sells the product made by the worker. He must so replace it that, as a rule, there remains to him a surplus above the cost of production expended by him. That is, he must get a profit. The selling price of the commodities produced by the worker is divided, from the point of view of the capitalist, into three parts. First, the replacement of the price of the raw materials advanced by him, in addition to the replacement of the wear and tear of tools, machines, and other instruments of labor, likewise advanced by him. Second, the replacement of the wages advanced. And third, the surplus left over, i.e. the profit of the capitalist. While the first part merely replaces previously existing values, it is evident that the replacement of the wages and surplus are as a whole taken out of the new value, which is produced by the labor of the worker and added to the raw materials. And in this sense, we can view new wages as well as profit for the purpose of comparing them with each other as shares in the product of the worker. Real wages may remain the same, they may even rise, nevertheless, the relative wages may fall. Let us suppose, for instance, that all means of subsistence have fallen 2/3 in price, while the day's wage have fallen but 1/3, for example, from 3 to 2 shillings. Although the worker can now get a greater amount of commodities with these 2 shillings than he had formerly, did the 3 shillings, yet his wages have decreased in proportion to the gain of the capitalist. The profit of the capitalist, of the manufacturers, for instance, have increased 1 shilling, which means that for a smaller amount of exchanged values, which he pays to the worker, the latter must produce a greater amount of exchange values than before. The share of capitals in proportion to the share of labor has risen. The distribution of social wealth between capital and labor has become still more unequal. The capitalist commands a greater amount of labor with the same capital. The power of the capitalist class over the working class has grown. The social position of the worker has become worse, has been forced down still another degree below the capitalist. What, then, is the general law that determines the rise and fall of wages and profit in their reciprocal relation? They stand in inverse proportion to each other. The share of profit increases in the same proportion in which the share of labor, wages, falls, and vice versa. Profit rises in the same degree in which wages fall. It falls in the same degree in which wages rise. It might perhaps be argued that the capitalist class gained by an advantageous exchange of his products with other capitalists by a rise in the demand for his commodities. Whether in consequence of the opening up of new markets or in a consequence of temporarily increased demands in the old market, and so on, that the profit of the capitalist, therefore, may be multiplied by taking advantage of other capitalists, independently of the rise and fall of wages, of the exchange value of labor power, or that of the profit of the capitalist may also rise through improvements in the instruments of labor, new applications of the force of nature, and so on. But in the first place, it must be admitted that the results remain the same, although brought about in the opposite manner. Profit, indeed, has not risen because wages have fallen, but wages have fallen because profit has risen. With the same amount of another man's labor, the capitalist bought a large amount of exchange values without having paid more for the labor on that account. I.e., the work is paid for less in proportion to the net gain which it yields to the capitalist. In the second place, it must be borne in mind that, despite the fluctuations in the prices of commodities, the average price of every commodity, the proportion in which it exchanges for other commodities, is determined by its cost of production. The acts of overreaching and taking advantage of one another within the capitalist ranks necessarily equalize themselves. The improvements of machinery, the new applications of forces of nature in the service of production make it possible to produce a given period of time with the same amount of labor and capital a larger amount of products, but in no wise a large amount of exchange values. If by the use of spinning machine I can furnish twice as much yarn in an hour as before, its invention, for instance, 100 pounds instead of 50 pounds, in the long run I receive back in exchange for this 100 pounds no more commodities than I did before 50, because the cost of the production has fallen by half, or because I can furnish double the product at the same cost. Finally, in whatsoever proportion the capitalist class, whether of one country or of the entire world market, distribute the net revenue of production amongst themselves, the total amount of this net revenue always consists exclusively of the amount by which accumulated labor has been increased from the proceeds of direct labor. This whole amount, therefore, grows in the same proportion in which labor augments capital, i.e., in the same proportion in which profit rises as compared with wages. The interests of capital and wage labor are diametrically opposed. Effect of growth of productive capital on wages. We thus see that even if we keep ourselves within the relation of capital and wage labor, the interests of capitals and the interest of wage labor are diametrically opposed to each other. A rapid growth of capital is synonymous with a rapid growth of profits. Profits can grow rapidly only when the price of labor, the relative wages, decrease just as rapidly. Relative wages may fall, although real wages rise simultaneously with nominal wages, with the money value of labor, provided only that real wage does not rise in the same proportion as the profit. If, for instance, in goods business years, wages rise 5%, while profits rise 30%, the relative wage has not increased, but decreased. If, therefore, the income of the worker increased with the rapid growth of capital, there is at the same time a widening of the social chasm that divides the worker from the capitalist, an increase in the power of capital over labor, a greater independence of labor upon capital. To say that the worker has an interest in the rapid growth of capital means only this, that the more speedily the worker augments the wealth of the capitalist, the larger will be the crumbs which fall to him, the greater will be the number of workers then can be called into existence, the more can the mass of slaves dependent upon capital be increased. We have seen thus that even the most favorable situation for the working class, namely the most rapid growth of capital, however much it may improve the material life of the worker, does not abolish the antagonism between his interests and the interests of the capitalist. Profit and wages remain, as before, in inverse proportion. If capital grows rapidly, wages may rise. But the profit of capital arises disproportionately faster. The material position of the worker has improved, but at the cost of his social position. The social chasm that separates him from the capitalist has widened. Finally, to say that the most favorable condition for the wage laborer is the fastest possible growth of productive capital is the same as to say the quicker the working class multiplies and augments the power inimicable to it, the wealth of another, which lords over that class, the more favorable will be the conditions under which it will be permitted to toil anew at the multiplication of bourgeois wealth, at the enlargement of power of capital, content thus far to forge itself the golden chains by which the bourgeoisie drags in its train. Growth of productive capital and rise of wages, are they really so indissolubly united as the bourgeois economists maintain? We must not believe their mere words. We dare not believe them, even when they claim that the fatter capital is the more will its slave be pampered. The bourgeoisie is too much enlightened. It keeps its account much too carefully, and share the prejudices of the feudal lord, who makes an ostentatious display of the magnificence of his retinue. The contents of the existence of the bourgeois compel it to attend carefully to its bookkeeping. We must therefore examine more closely into the following question. In what matter does the growth of productive capital affect wages? If, as a whole, the productive capital of bourgeois society grows, there takes place a more many-sided accumulation of labor. The individual capitals increase in number and magnitude. The multiplications of individual capitals increase the competition among capitalists. The increasing magnitude of increasing capitals provides the means of leading more powerful armies of workers with more gigantic instruments of war upon the industrial battlefield. The one capitalist can drive the other from the field and carry off his capital only by selling more cheaply. In order to sell more cheaply without ruining himself, he must produce more cheaply, i.e. increase the productive forces of labor as much as possible. But the productive forces of his labor is increased above all by greater division of labor, by a more general introduction and constant improvement of machinery. The larger the army of workers among whom the labor is subdivided, the more gigantic the scale upon which machinery is introduced, the more in proportion does the cost of production decrease, the more fruitful is the labor, and so there arises among the capitalists a universal rivalry for the increase of the division of labor and of machinery, and for their exploitation upon the greatest possible scale. If now, by a greater division of labor, and by the application and improvement of new machines, by a more advantageous exploitation of the forces of nature on a larger scale, a capitalist has found the means of producing but the same amount of labor, whether it be direct or accumulated labor, a larger amount of products of commodities than his competitors. If, for instance, he can produce a whole yard of linen in the same labor time in which his competitors weave half a yard, how will this capitalist act? He could keep on selling half a yard of linen at old market price, but this would not have an effect of driving his opponents from the field and enlarging his own market. But his need of a market has increased in the same measure in which his productive power has extended. The more powerful and costly means of production that he is called into existence enable him, it is true, to sell his wares more cheaply, but they compel him at the same time to sell wares to get control of a very much greater market for his commodities. Consequently, this capitalist will sell his half yard of linen more cheaply than his competitors. But the capitalist will not sell the whole yard so cheaply as his competitors sell the half yard, although the production of the whole yard costs him no more than it does of the half yard to the others. Otherwise, he would make no extra profit and would get back in exchange only the cost of production. He might obtain a greater income from having set in motion a larger capital, but not from having made a greater profit on his capital than others. Moreover, he attains the object he is aiming at if he prices his goods only a small percentage lower than his competitors. He drives them off the field. He wrests them from at least a part of their market by underselling them. And finally, let us remember that the current price always stands either above or below the cost of production, according as the sale of commodity takes place in the favorable or unfavorable period of the industry. According as the marketplace of the yard of linen stands above or below its former cost of production, will the percentage vary at which the capitalist who has made use of the new or more faithful means of production sell above his real cost of production. But the privilege of our capitalist is not of longer duration. Of other competing capitalists introduce the same machines, the same division of labor, and introduce them upon the same or even upon a greater scale. And finally, this introduction becomes so universal that the price of linen is lowered not only below its old, but even below its new cost of production. The capitalists, therefore, find themselves in their mutual relations, in the same situation in which they were before the introduction of the new means of production, and if they are by these means enabled to offer double the product at the old price, they are now forced to furnish double the product for less than the old price. Having arrived at the new point, the new cost of production, the battle for supremacy in the market has to be fought out anew, given more division of labor and more machinery, and there results a greater scale upon which division of labor and machinery are exploited, and the competition again brings the same reaction against this result. Effect of capitalist competition on the capitalist class, the middle class, and the working class. We thus see how the method of production and the means of production are constantly enlarged, revolutionized, how division of labor necessarily draws after it greater division of labor, the employment of machinery, greater employment of machinery, work upon a scale, work upon a still greater scale. This is the law that continually throws capitalist production out of its old ruts and compels capital to strain ever more the productive forces of labor for the very reason that it has already strained them, the law that grants it no respite and constantly shouts in its ear, March! March! This is no other law than which, within the periodical fluctuations of commerce, necessarily adjusts the price of a commodity to its cost of production. No matter how powerful the means of production which a capitalist may bring into the field, competition will make their adoption general, and from the moment that they have been generally adopted, the sole result of the greater productiveness of his capital will be that he must furnish at the same price 10, 20, 100 times as much as before. But since he must find a market for, perhaps, 1,000 times as much in order to outweigh the lower selling price by a greater quantity of the sale, since now a more extensive sale is necessary, not only to gain a greater profit, but also in order to replace the cost of production. And since this more extensive sale has become a question of life and death, not only for him, but also for his rivals, the old struggle must begin again, and it is all the more violent, the more powerful the means of production already invented are. The division of labor and the application of machinery will therefore take a fresh start, and upon an even greater scale. Whatever be the power of means of production which are employed, competition seeks to rob capital of the golden fruits of this power by reducing the price of commodities to the cost of production. In the same measure in which production is cheapened, i.e., in the same measure in which more can be produced with the same amount of labor. It compels by a law which is irresistible a still greater cheapening of production, the sale of ever greater masses of profit for smaller prices. Thus, the capitalist will have gained nothing more by his efforts than the obligation to furnish a greater product in the same labor time, in a word, more difficult conditions for profitable employment of his capital. While competition, therefore, constantly pursues him with its law of the cost of production and turns against himself every weapon that he forces against his rivals, the capitalist continually seeks to get the best of competition by restlessly introducing further subdivision of labor and new machines, which, though more expensive, enable him to produce more cheaply instead of waiting until the new machines shall have been rendered obsolete by competition. If we now conceive that this feverish agitation as it operates in the market of the whole world, we shall be in position to comprehend how the growth of accumulation and concentration of capital bring in their train an ever more detailed subdivision of labor, an ever greater improvement of old machines, and a constant application of new machine, a process which goes on uninterruptedly with a feverish haste and upon an ever more gigantic scale. But what effect do these conditions, which are inseparable from the growth of productive capital, have upon the determination of wages? The greater division of labor enables one laborer to accomplish the work of 5, 10, or 20 laborers. It therefore increases competition among the laborers 5-fold, 10-fold, or 20-fold. The laborers compete not only by selling themselves one cheaper than another, but also by one doing the work of 5, 10, or 20, and they are forced to compete in this manner by the division of labor which is introduced and steadily improved by capital. Furthermore, to the same degree in which the division of labor increases, is the labor simplified. The special skill of the laborer becomes worthless. He becomes transformed into a simple, monotonous force of production, with neither physical nor mental elasticity. His work becomes accessible to all. Therefore, competitors press upon him from all sides. Moreover, it must be remembered that the more simple, the more easily learned the work is, so much the less its cost to production, the expense of its acquisition, and so much the lower must the wages sink. For, like the price of any other commodity, they are determined by the cost of production. Therefore, in the same manner in which the laborer becomes more unsatisfactory, the more repulsive do competition increase and wages decrease. The laborer seeks to maintain the total of his wages for a given time by performing more labor, either by working a greater number of hours or by accomplishing more in the same number of hours. Thus urged on by want, he himself multiplies the disastrous effects of division of labor. The result is, the more he works, the less wages he receives. And for this simple reason, the more he works, the more he competes against his fellow workmen, the more he compels them to compete against him, and to offer themselves on the same wretched conditions as he does, so that, in the analysis, he competes against himself as a member of the working class. Machinery produces the same effects, but upon a much larger scale. It supplants skilled workers by unskilled men, by women, adults, by children. Where newly introduced, it throws workers upon the streets in great masses, and as it becomes more highly developed and more productive, it discards them in additional through smaller numbers. We have hastily sketched in broad outlines the industrial war of capitalists among themselves. This war has the peculiarity that the battles in it are won less by recruiting than by discharging the army of workers. The generals, the capitalists, vie with one another as to who can discharge the greatest number of industrial soldiers. The economists tell us, to be sure, that those laborers who have been rendered superfluous by machinery find new venues of employment. They dare not assert directly that the same laborers that have been discharged find situations in new branches of labor. Facts cry out too loudly against this lie. Strictly speaking, they only maintain that new means of employment will be found for other sections of the working class. For example, for that portion of the young generation of laborers who were about to enter upon that branch of industry, which has just been abolished, of course, This is a great satisfaction to the disabled laborers. There will be no lack of fresh, exploitable blood and muscle for the miseres. Capitalists, the dead, may bury their dead. This consolation seems to be intended more for the comfort of the capitalists themselves than the laborers. If the whole class of wage laborer were to be annihilated by machinery, how terrible that would be for capital, which, without wage labor, ceases to be capital. But even if we assume that all who are directly forced out of employment by machinery, as well as all of the rising generation who were waiting for the chance of employment in the same branch of industry, do actually find some new employment, are we to believe that this new employment will pay as high wages as did the ones they lost? If it did, it would be in contradiction to the laws of political economy. We have seen how modern industry always tends to the substitution of the simpler and more subordinate employments for the higher and more complex ones. How, then, could a mass of workers thrown out of one branch of industry by machinery find refuge in another branch unless they were to be paid more poorly? An exception to the law has been adduced, namely the workers who are employed in the manufacture of machinery itself. As soon as there is an industry a greater demand for and a greater consumption of machinery, it is said that the number of machines must necessarily increase. Consequently, also, the manufacture of machines, consequently also the employment of workers in machine manufacture, and the workers employed in this branch of industry are skilled, even educated, workers. Since the year 1840, this assertion, which even before that date was only half true, has lost all semblance of truth. For the most diverse machines are now applied to the manufacture of machines themselves, on quite the extensive scale as in the manufacture of cotton and yarn. And the laborers employed in machine factories can but play the role of very stupid machines alongside of the highly ingenious machines. But in the place of the man who has been dismissed by the machine, the factory may employ, perhaps, 3 children and 1 woman. And must not wages of the man have previously sufficed for 3 children and 1 woman? Must not the minimum wages have sufficed for the preservation and propagation of the race? What, then, do these beloved bourgeois phrases prove? Nothing more than that now 4 times as many workers' lives are used up as there were previously in order to obtain the livelihood of 1 working family. To sum up, the more productive capital grows, the more it extends the division of labor and the application of machinery, the more the division of labor and the application of machinery extend. The more does the competition extend among the workers, the more do the wages shrink together. In addition, the working class is also recruited from the higher strata of society. A mass of small businessmen and living people upon the interest of their capitals is precipitated into the ranks of the working class, and they will have nothing else to do than to stretch out their arms alongside of the arms of the workers. Thus the forest of outstretched arms, begging for work, grows ever thicker, while the arms themselves grow ever leaner. It is evident that the small manufacturer cannot survive in a struggle in which the first condition of success is production upon an even greater scale. It is evident that the small manufacturers, and thereby increasing the number of candidates for the proletariat, all this requires no further elucidation. Finally, in the same measure in which the capitalists are compelled, by the movement described above, to exploit the already existing gigantic means of production on an ever-increasing scale, and for the purpose to set in motion all mainsprings of credit, in the same measure do they increase the industrial earthquakes, in the midst of which the commercial world can preserve itself only by sacrificing a portion of its wealth, its products, and even its forces of production to the gods of the lower world. In short, the crises increase, they become more frequent and more violent, if for no other reason than for this alone, that in the same measure in which the masses of products grows, and therefore the need of extensive markets, in the same measure does the world market shrink ever more, and ever few markets remain to be exploited. Since every previous crisis has subjugated to the commerce of the world a hitherto unconquered or but superficially exploited market. But capital not only lives upon labor, like a master at once distinguished and barbarous, it drags with it into its grave the corpses of its slaves, whole hecatombs of workers who perish in these crises. We thus see that if capital grows rapidly, competition among the workers grows with even greater rapidity, i.e., the means of employment and subsistence for the working class decrease in proportion even more rapidly. But this, notwithstanding the rapid growth of capital, is the most favorable condition for wage labor.